Welcome everybody to the Harry Bridges School of Labor. Tonight's class will be a viewing of Harlan County USA, a documentary on the 1973 and 74 Brookside Mine Strike that took place. I'm sure you'll be surprised to hear this in Harlan County USA, in Harlan County in West Virginia. The Harry Bridges School of Labor is presented by Labor United Educational League. Our purpose is to educate the workers of America on the strength of unions and to foster a class-conscious workforce. We aim to connect the struggles of the past with the struggles of today to empower the labor movement to transform the present hopeless defensive fight into an aggressive attack upon capital. We plan to empower workers with knowledge regardless of industry or type of work, bringing all workers to a class-oriented trade union movement. And once again, tonight's class is on a viewing of Harlan County, USA, a pivotal strike in the 70s.
Yeah, I think this movie is a good example of kind of what red baiting was like at the time, because it might be in the second part that we see that. Forget at which point in the movie it goes over it, but some of the organizers were red baited, and that's how the company tried to discredit them. There was also use of scabs. There's just a general level of conflict that's shown in the movie that sometimes people today don't really see. But given current events and the way things might be going, especially with the NLRA being in the Supreme Court and the NLRB as well,
yeah, unity,
it's a level of militancy that we're going to have to return to.
Yeah.
Thank you. And we broke down this documentary into six parts, shown over between tonight and Saturday night, roughly between 17 and 18 minutes each part, so we could get the whole movie in. And with that, we'll get started.
mighty long time. I labor down tall, down in a coal mine, down in a deep hole, where the bright light did glow. Back in a dark room, a fading up coal. My bones, they did ache me. My kneecaps got bad. Down on a hard rock, on a set of knee pads. The motors were shifting. I got sand in my hair. Both lungs were broke down from a breathing bad air. Coal mining was rough. 18 and 20 hours. Get wet, come outside, and your clothes be put close to stiff. It would sound like fiber hit them, make a rattling noise. It worked you like working a mule or a brute. I had the boss man to say one time, he said, you be sure, don't get that mule. No place where the rock will fall in on him. Don't take that mule to no bad place. I said, well, what about me? I was driving a mule in. What about me? The rock will fall in on me. He said, we can always hire another man. He said, you've got to buy that mule. In other words, he thought more of the mule than did a man.
Miner and belonged to the union, the UMW, and he died with black lung. I can remember sitting around, you know, when we were younger, and him talking about being on picket lines and organizing, and I mean that was mostly what we talked about, sitting around the table after supper and all. Most of our conversation was his union, you know, when he was organizing for the union and things that happened on the picket line and things that the company did to you. And so I began to hate the company, you know. I mean, that seemed like I just always did. I knew they were enemy, you know. And then when I watched him die and suffer like he did with that black lung disease, I knew that something could be done about it. And I told myself then, if I ever get the opportunity to get those coal operators, I will. Because I thought, you know, the enemy. And so when this track came up, I saw the opportunity and I jumped right in there.
Let's get up here at 5 o'clock in the morning and fix you a good cup of coffee. Let's be down there and show these Brookside workers what we can do for them. Let's stand on our 2 feet and show these boys that we can help them get a contract. Let's show the people in Harlan County we stand together. If you file for this contract, we're going to get it. Hey, the fire's done hot now. It ain't much you can do. All you boys over on that football field or anything, would you be here in the morning? Let's show Carl Hound that we stand on 2 feet here in Harlan County. We'll sit there and sweat when it's snowing. We'll stand right there until that UMWA contract is signed at Brookside. All you people here in Black Mountain, we'd really appreciate it if you'd be down there at 5 o'clock, Sunrise Revival at Brookside, Kentucky. Let's don't back off. Let's don't let one man run us out of Harlan. Yeah, boys, that's where it's happening. Brookside at 5 o'clock. Monday morning. Let's be down there to support the Brookside workers.
I got hurt down there about a year ago at Brookside. I had about 300 pounds of steel on my head. And they took me to the hospital, sewed my head up, had a hole cut through my nose here. And I was off one day, and the superintendent sent a fella over and said, get him to come on back up here and work so we'll make it easy on him so he won't lose no time. And I went back up there, and it knocked me out of compensation or anything. Went back there with my head busted open. That's the way they want you to work down there.
Protect your family, UMWA. Go in there, boys. Meet your support.
Thanks so much, buddy. It's nice stuff to have. Now you're a real pal. Meet your support. May the good Lord take a liking to you.
I know I will.
Yeah.
Hey, I'll put UMWA all the way. UMWA all the way.
I'm on the bumper there. Tennessee is a UMW thing.
We're out of Kentucky, sisters, and we need more men.
Organize the unorganized. With organization, you have the aid of your fellow men. Without organization, you are a lone individual. Without influence, and without recognition of any kind. And exploitation of you and your family when it pleases some industrialist who desires to make money from your misery.
But we'd like to have every man that'll walk his picket duty with us to get his name before he leaves, and we'll break it up. These boys on this committee will break it down, and we'll get something going here. Come on up and sit around. It ain't no big thing. You ain't gonna be doing nothing no way. Crying about how broke you are like I am.
We sure appreciate that. You would like
us. We're protesting. We're protesting Duke Power's control over these men that voted in the UMW contract, and Duke Power says, no, you can't have that contract.
We have made them dozens and dozens of proposals of different language in these areas of disagreement. They read them and throw them back. They have no counterproposal.
If you could settle it quietly, I would think maybe you'd do it and say, well, maybe they won this battle, but we've got them off our back.
Well, I would agree with you to this extent. I'd like to have them off our back.
They're treating us like that we're animals, dogs. Well, we aren't. We're American citizens. And they are violating their constitutional rights when they tell us that we can't have the union of our choice that those men voted in. If you looked on TV the other day, you seen women going up there, men, impeach Nixon, impeach Nixon. But you let us get up there with protest signs against Duke Power, and they're sending their gun thugs to intimidate us.
What do you think when the unions are destroying our whole country? Mr. Hoppus in the penitentiary. Teamster Union are known communists. Longshoremen are known communists. Every union in the country is striking. What will happen to our country?
The men want higher wages. They're going to strike further. The union is bagging them. They stay on strike till they get their higher wages. I explained to my daughter, I said, there's a spool of thread there. I said, that thread might have been 15 cents. The man goes on strike. I said, and if they get 30 more cents on an hour, they get their 30 cents. When they go back to work, they got to raise that price to cover that wage. The unions is what's doing it. The unions is running the United States.
I went to work when I was 10 years old picking slate in the Kohlberger. Well, at that time, we were working 10 hours a day, and we were getting 6 and a fraction cents an hour. Well, we breaker boys, we'd have our feet in the chute, and we'd be picking the slate out. Well, the breaker boss would sneak up behind us, and if he'd see a piece of slate coming through, he'd pick up the slate and hit you in the back with it, and hit you hard. And he'd say, pick that slate out, you know? Well, they used to abuse us, actually. Well, finally, we got to a stage where we figured that, well, we was going to strike. That was when I learned my first real political lesson about what happens when you take a position against the coal operators, against the capitalists. Well, the first thing that happened, the union officials came to us and told us that we'd have to go back to work, that we were violating the agreement. We said, to hell with the agreement. We're going to stay out and strike until we get our demands. Well, then the politicians began visiting us and putting pressure on us. Then the parish priest. Well, finally, the coal company did agree to meet with us. And they agreed to raise the hourly pay from 6 and a fraction cents to 8 cents an hour. So we thought we got big concessions today. That wouldn't mean anything. That's only peanuts. But it meant a whole lot to us in our paycheck at that period. Well, this was my first lesson that if you stuck to yourself, stuck to your organization, and stuck together in solidarity, you could defeat them. Besides that, I learned that the politicians worked with the coal companies. I found out that the union officials were working with the coal companies. I also found out that the Catholic hierarchy was working with the coal officials. Here was a combination of the whole thing, you see, that you had to bump up against the whole combination of them. When the coal and iron police would find out who was trying to instigate a union, well, they'd abuse them. The miners figured, well, the only way they could fight back was to abuse them, pay them for what they was doing. So they begin to use then violence in retaliation of the violence that was being used against them. This kind of a struggle went on to such a degree that there was many of the mine foremen getting killed. There was many of the police getting killed. And of course, there was many miners getting killed. And it was a regular guerrilla warfare. This was some of the early ideas of guerrilla warfare that developed out of that kind of struggle.
The coal company gets every dollar which he can chisel out of some coal miner through oppressive management tactics. So why wouldn't the coal operators be satisfied? The government is acting as their muscle man.
Back money, Kentucky at work, breaking the organized labor. Organized labor. Organized labor.
Well, hell, I don't think Dennis is in here for anything except break the strike here. They're for the company all the way.
The guys wouldn't be up there if the state troopers were.
I don't have any feelings one way or the other. Just have a job.
And why are you here?
Keep the roads open. Forest laws, keep the peace. Try to keep people from getting hurt.
Put your hand on me, Hall. Bailey. I know my name's Bailey, but you're a damn disgrace to the Bailey family.
What's this damn shame? Well, Bailey, you're on a state cop. They got a shame.
You ought to get a shot or something. Get a shot of this baby hanging on. That's what I've been looking at.
It's the same diameter as this right here.
What's the scab? There are no healing for a scab, you know?
Yeah, that's some nerve bone. That's some nerve bone.
Here it comes!
Junction, all 36 of you, remember this.
Well, that will break for our first round of questions and comments.
Hey, so just a little curious, was this movie filmed after the end of the strike, or was it during, or, well, I guess during, but was some of it after as well, interspersed?
Yeah, this came out after the strike, I believe. Not long after, because it came out the same year the strike ended. The strike took place in 1973 and 74, and this did come out in 1974. But one thing I noticed, of course, cops were there to open up the road so the scabs could get in. shows where their loyalties lie. They're there to enforce the system, and the system isn't in the benefit of the workers.
So there was a few of them that they mentioned how, you know, they learned a lot about politics through the strike. You know, they got to see how the whole state apparatus, the churches, and et cetera, come together to, even the unions, come together to, you know, to work to end the strikes. And I was just curious if, you know, what's different today? You know, does AFL-CIO employ tactics today that shields the people from seeing all this, the political stuff behind the scenes, or is it more or less the same as it used to be?
It's not as glaringly obvious, especially when you think about the guy I remember specifically mentioning that was talking about earlier strikes in the 30s, 40s, that were, the repression was much greater than it was here, even though, and that was even greater than it is that we know of today, because it's not really seen today like it was in the past. And part of that is the way the media covers it. Perfect example would be the potential railroad strike 2 years ago. If you listen to, you know, the media here, you'd think it was about 6 days, and it was a much deeper, broader struggle than simples. And 6 days didn't even come into sick days weren't even a part of their demands until late in the bargaining, because all of the other demands were essentially thrown out by federal mediators. So it's not as glaring in your face today, but most workers see it.
Hi, I was just wondering, does a wildcat strike also refer to like a strike that the union doesn't want you to do, or is it just a strike that's technically illegal?
A wildcat strike is a strike that's not authorized by the union.
Okay.
Technically, all wildcat strikes are illegal. Though there are measures in which a wildcat strike can become legal, by one of those being decertifying the old union and creating a new one. But I would definitely not recommend a rank and file going through that. That puts you at a, in many cases, there's a waiting period before you can create a new union after a union's decertified. And in some states, it's longer than others. It's not something I would recommend if possible, but in some cases it may need to be done. There's actually one more thing I wanted to say. There was a couple people that they interviewed there talking about, well, there was the first guy that Tim mentioned in the opening, calling a bunch of communists and Reds and all that. And there was a guy that came right after him, blaming the union for ruining the country because they're driving up prices and inflation by demanding higher wages. If that doesn't show you what, I can't even put into words how I feel about somebody like that. It's how disgusted it makes me. But with that, we'll move on to our second part.
It's court order. You can't block the traffic, and don't call them scabs. Because if you do, you'll be down there behind bars.
I don't think you'll never win a strike by having six people on the picket line.
Now,
there's no way. I mean, that you can win a strike with six pickets, so you got to violate these injunctions. And the lawyers are made to get you out of trouble after you get in, not to get you out of trouble before you get in.
I'll put it like this. You do what you want to do.
Women all over the country are interested in what their husbands are doing. They're interested in the safety laws that the United Mine Workers have, and they want their husbands to have the pension funds. They don't want their husbands going into these scab mines with a rock a-falling and running these here motors with no brakes. So they want to participate. They're ready and willing. The good thing about our club is that now we're giving them the chance to participate, you see. When their husbands goes in the mines, that they're praying that they'll get out. I think that they feel like it, maybe their prayers will be answered sooner if they're working under UMWA contract.
Well, I went down there in support of the miners, for the miners, and in support of my own children, too, that I'm raising up.
Now, sit down real easy. Sit down. I'm now running water.
I can't get my foot.
Angie.
I couldn't get my foot out.
If the scab starts across the picket lines, we went because we was trying to protect, you know, the scab's going to take your daddy's job. When he signed the contract, daddy's going to have hot running water and a big old bathtub. Come on, you coal miners, wherever you may be, and listen to a story that I'll relate to thee. My name is nothing extra, but the truth to you I'll tell. I am a coal miner's wife, I'm sure I wish you well. They take your very lifeblood, they take our children's lives. Take fathers away from children, and husbands away from wives. Oh, miner, won't you organize wherever you may be, and make this a land of freedom for workers like you and me.
And we have to fight for our rights. You're going to have to fight for that. If you have more safety in the mines, if you get your portal-to-portal pay, if you have your doctor card, you can be doctor. Because if you get disabled and you don't have any backing, then some home will get you or your family will die. For you see, I know what it means. And this club means a lot to pull us all together. Everybody stand together in it. And everybody goes together. Everybody go out on the picket line, and we'll win their contract if they'll all stand up.
That's good, Katie. That's good. All the police were lined up there when we got there. It was early. We must have got there at 4:45, maybe 5:30, but they were there already. And by that time, all this big crowd had gathered, you know, supporters. One car went through with three men in it. They kind of slipped through. And the next car that come through, we were able to get in the road and lay down.
Come on, girls, lay down. Let them see what kind of law we got in Harlan County. State police we got.
Get them bastards manhandling women.
That's what to do. We didn't give them any resistance, whatever. We just laid down in the road because they were there to escort those scabs through to work. And that's been going on for a whole month. And we just come too far for that.
Take your pictures, boys!
Get them, sir.
Oh, honey, they gotta stay on that picket line. If they start scabbing, man, they gotta go back down there. They can't let me down. I mean, that shit, just bring me a gun if they're going. I'd rather be dead if I have to know that they're scabbing at Brookside. I can't stand it. I can't stand the thought of it. So just don't let them, you know, stay on the picket line, always on the picket line. I really mean it. They'll just keep on the picket line. I'll be like Billy. And they'll just beat the hell out of them scabs. Beat the shit right out of them.
Which one ain't took?
I don't know, but I got this.
This top one ain't took yet. It's a double mattress. I'll take this one.
Hell, I was legally on the picket line.
Yeah, I told him he was. I tried to show him in court down there, and they wouldn't accept the damn thing.
Let's go violate one more time. Then that puts right back. Yeah. Because you're a prisoner out there anyway.
Right.
So you might as well
just be in jail. There's a judgment of the court that built on Joy Elder, Laura Scott, Betty Elder, Bessie Cornett, and Melvin Strong. Be incarcerated for a period of 60 days from this day.
Could I say, because I haven't had a chance to give any testimony today, I knew we weren't going to get any justice. You say the laws were made for us. The laws are not made for the working people in this country. there's a person missing here today, and that's Carl Horn. The law was made for people like Carl Horn, not for us. So I knew when I came here, without offering any testimony or getting up, I knew what I was doing at Brookside because that's what I wanted to do. For once, I was able to take the offensive instead of coming down here to take a step backward to try to defend what we did. What we did is right, and we all know that.
I resent the fact that they, Judge Hogg is a trimee and him a coal operator, and that sitting beside him, the circuit court clerk, Mary Lou Coldarn, is sitting up there, and her son is up there. He's a photographer up there taking the pictures for him to blacklist the men on the picket line. I resent that. I resent the fact that he can make a law that can tell me that I can't go where I please. He's violating my constitutional right.
My name is Norman Yarborough. On my right is Mr. Logan Patterson, who is an attorney, has been retained by the Eastover Mining Company as chief negotiator.
Mr. Yarborough, I'd like to ask you what you think about the role the miners' wives played in the strike.
Well, they certainly played a big role in it. I would hate to think that my wife would play this kind of role.
Why?
Well, there's been some conduct that I don't like to think that our American women have to revert to.
Is it a fact that the Duke Power Company maintains housing for its employees that has no water and no indoor plumbing?
Yes, sir. We were attempting to move our people, and these are our people. They're my people. Move our people, upgrade our people into trailers. Upgrade our people into better housing, better conditions in all directions, because they'll make us better people when we are able to do this.
Larry, come on the subway.
It's a feudal system, I think. There's a very rich class of people, and then there are the coal miners. And then there are the people who are on relief. And that's about it in Harlem. They want to keep it this way. The way they keep it that way is keeping monopoly on the labor market. And they do that by keeping other competitive or industries that will be competitive, you know, for the labor, keep them out.
There are a few little places work, but I mean, they don't pay enough at the minimum wage hour, you know, maybe $2 an hour. And you can't make a living with that no more, you know. And if it don't go United Mine Works, me and him have to leave Harlan County, that's for sure, or maybe Kentucky. We'll have to go where it's a union state to get a job again.
Duke Power is a southern conservative company. Less than 10% of their employees in their power plants and their line crews are organized. And they feel that if they give in to a contract here, it will encourage union organization in their home state of North Carolina and South Carolina.
They say in North Carolina, Duke Power runs the show. Carl Horn would like to break the strike, but the miners tell him no. Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Growing up in New York City, we've got to spread the news. Been fighting hard for many months, and we're not about to lose. Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on?
You're from the South? Can I have one of those?
Yeah, he looks like he's from the South.
Thank you. Oh, he don't look like y'all are from
the We're going to let people know that if you buy Duke Power stock, it's risky. We've had several this morning. Said they had Duke Power stock, but they wouldn't have it long. That they were going to get rid of it. And that sound beautiful to me.
The tunnels here is just like a mine's.
Yeah.
Only ours is about 42 inches high.
I think these are more secure than a mine, so I wouldn't mind going under here, but your mines.
Oh, yeah. You wouldn't want to go into mines?
No.
They can make good profit off the mines, you know. If they had a union, they won't give us one.
They make good profit, but they keep it all themselves, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't spread the wealth. I thought you guys got paid a little more than you do. You don't get paid a bad salary, but I thought it was a little
We get paid real good.
No, it's not.
But, you know.
What's real good?
Look,
$5, $6 an hour?
Yeah.
That's not real good. I make more than that.
Yeah?
Sure I do.
The policeman makes less down there.
We make about $7.
God, it's good money. We draw union strike benefits. And it's real hard, you know, to live on $100. Is your job real dangerous, though?
Look, this is what I do. It's a lot of bullshit.
I mean, a lot of people don't understand that that electricity burning over there, there's somebody dying every day for it. There's one man dies every day. You probably got medical coverage.
Free
medical coverage. I'd save up money, buy a house or something other. Kids all get sick and I'd have to spend every penny.
What about dental?
No dental. You got dental?
Dental. We got all kinds of health. We got drugs. I can retire at 36. Half pay, $10,000 a year.
Well, now they don't want us to ever be able to retire.
That's bad.
That's the reason we're here. You know, that's the reason we're on strike. Been on strike 9 months.
9 months?
9 months.
I thought it was the first day.
No, this is 9 months. We can't get a, they won't sign
a
contract.
Good thing you came up here to bring some publicity to us.
Yeah, yeah.
The outstanding issues between Duke Power's coal mining subsidiary, Silver Mining Company, and the United Mine Workers, in the opinion of the management of Eastover and the management of Duke Power, experience, are the absence of a no-strike clause, the refusal of the union to agree to not strike during the life of the contract. If there are questions on the content of my report to the stockholders, I will entertain those questions.
How come you hire gun thugs to harass us around with? You saying there that the issue is for a no-strike clause. Well, if we had a no-strike clause in there, Norman Yarbrough could kick us off of that hill and there wouldn't be a thing we could do about it. But I tell you, we are in Harlan County, all of our life, we've been kicked around, we've been put in jail, we've been shot at, we've had dynamite thrown at us, and then you don't want us to have nothing. Well, I tell you, Mr. Horn, I'm going to be standing right there on that picket line looking at you and just as long as it takes. Thank you.
Coal companies are not the J.P. Morgans or the Hannas anymore. It's Occidental Petroleum and Exxon and Sahio. They're the ones, the oil companies, control the coal industry. 70% of all the domestic coal reserves are owned by oil companies.
There just can't be any question that the health and the safety of our employees in the mining industry must be given first priority. On humanitarian grounds alone,
we find violation after violation after violation in those mines. We have a national record that looks very poor when laid up against the German national record, the UK national record, the French national record, the Netherlands national record, and the others that I've examined. So I think that I'm not indicting anyone. If anything, I'm indicting myself. I'm indicting an agency that I've been associated with for a long time. We haven't done all that we should have in this field.
God, Frankie, I sit the whole midnight shift and the mine blew up. They're trapped in a mine and I said, Pete's in there too.
He left for work and he acted, well, just kind of like he didn't want to go to work. He'd rather stayed home. He said, maybe I should stay home. I said, why don't you? And he went to the door about two or three different times, kept saying, should I go or should I stay home? He said, it's spitting snow out there. And he said, I just hate to be on the road. I said, why don't you stay home then and pretend you're sick tonight? But he went, and then that was the explosion. So
I live right on, almost on the seat of the main explosion, right, Sarah? And they said, you get out of your house. And the police told me to get out. But you know why? Because they was notified telling me to get out. Because they didn't want me to see what was going on up that damn dirty, filthy mines.
I give up. I figured we'd never make it out. Because we all passed out. I don't know whether any one man didn't pass out or not. I couldn't say that because I know I did. When I woke up, I was like bruised to death.
I've worked in the mines about 7 years, and I've really never been too scared of the mines. But I don't think I'll go back in the mines.
And the television says, if another explosion would occur, they'd have to seal the mine. And about 1 o'clock, that explosion came, and I says, they'll seal.
They sealed them, and then we knew that was it.
You can read it in the paper and the radio tells us to raise our children to be miners as well. Tell them how safe the mines are today, and to be like Daddy, bring home a big pay. But don't you believe him, my boy, that story's a lie. Remember the disaster at the Mannington mine, where 78 miners were burned alive. Cause of unsafe condition, your daddy.
And I would like to know, since they died, in order to help the living, find out what caused that.
And with that, we'll break for our second round of questions and comments.
The story is heartbreaking. The litany of music around the events and everything, I really would like to get a compilation of it because it's both haunting and beautiful. Thank you.
I just wanted to say that I think it was awesome how involved all the wives were and how, like, on point they were. They were awesome. I appreciated that a lot.
Yeah, that was common in all major strike struggles. It was, believe it or not, Mate One Massacre, the wives were involved in that strike. You name a major strike in American history, none of these labor victories could have happened without the wives. They fought almost as hard, if not harder, than the men workers who were actually the strikers themselves.
Oh. Yeah, the part where the miner's talking to the policeman and he's so, like, shocked by how terrible their conditions are, that stood out to me a lot. And he was even more shocked to discover that that wasn't even their first day on strike. It was like 9 months in. It's crazy how long they fought for their rights.
There's a theme that they've been trying to show, and it's important. It's an important one because it was mentioned by one of the people who were interviewed, is that this was a educational experience to them. That they, through the strike, they started to learn.
I was thinking about
where the
go back to
politicians, their loyalties lied,
work,
the companies, how they were all involved together. And that's important because today, a lot of unions, especially mine, they have no strike clauses. And if there's no struggle, if there's no education on the class struggle, then what follows is the growth of a very anti-worker mentality. People start getting buddy-buddy with the cops. They start to see strikes as a nuisance. They don't understand strikes. They don't understand organizing in general. A very conservative outlook takes over.
And I could say from personal experience, I've seen that in my own union meetings. When the idea of a strike comes up, there's so many people that are just so willing to take the scraps to not actually get involved in the struggle. And it's demoralizing to an extent, but we must fight through that urge.
Yeah, I was curious. I know that scab labor is still a thing, but what were unions able from then till now able to fight for legislation that would regulate or restrict the use of scab labor in any way?
I mean, of course, unions have lobbied for it. I may be wrong, but I believe that there might have been a provision in the PRO Act around scab labor that we know was promised and never passed. But of course, that's something that unions could lobby for, but without the struggle aspect, nothing's going to succeed.
Yeah, for right now, there's nothing that actually prevents scabs. And I would say that what we're, like, you heard in the movie that there was a court injunction that kind of limited where the strikers could be. There's something about the six strikers could only be there at any one point in time. When we were following the Warrior Met coal strike, they also had a court injunction filed against them. They couldn't even be within 500 yards of the entrance to the plant. So the difference, though, is that the workers there, they didn't care. There was a court injunction filed, and they basically tore it to shreds. And they showed up anyway. There's more hesitancy today to do that.
And yeah, that hesitancy is one major aspect that's hindered a lot of struggles. I mean, a perfect example, the potential UPS strike last year. A deal was made last minute that is increasingly seen by rank and file UPS Teamsters wasn't in their best interest. They would have been better off striking. And one thing I want to say before we move on to the next section, you know, they were talking about the mine explosion. And, you know, I tried to Google it to get more information on the mine explosion. But unfortunately, there's been so many since then, just in Harlan County, that it's impossible. It's been difficult for me to do. It's impossible to do a quick search. And it's going to take more time to dig in to find out about that mine explosion more. And it's just sad how little things have changed this new.
And I would like to know, since they died, in order to help the living, find out what caused that explosion. You know, you learn from a tragedy. And then maybe they could help
others
to live, and then it wouldn't happen again. But as long as they're greedy, and as long as they're rushing the coal miner and wanting the production before lives, there'll always be tragedies.
I know there's something wrong, but I didn't know what it was. And the doctors told me.
About 60, don't you?
Yeah, about 60, somewhere along there.
What would happen to you when you started realizing that something was wrong?
Well, you just couldn't get no breath. You'd walk a little piece and you'd give out, just panting for breath. And sometimes you couldn't hardly get it no way. Lots of times I've had to go to the hospital down here at the doctor, and they gave me some shots and things, and I thought I was a goner.
Black lung, pull your hands, I see cold. As you reach for my life and you torture my soul. Where I spent my life's blood, digging my own grave.
When you start destroying the lung tissue, as occurs in miners who have pneumoconiosis and the end result of pneumoconiosis, there really isn't anything that you can do to restore the lungs. It's just simply destroyed. Mm-hmm. 170 over 100.
Buckley, how old a man are you?
I'm 67.
Well, you couldn't see your buddy on the other side of the car for today. We'd be covered just black. Well, you don't make every color when you went in it. You all be looked the same when you came out.
Right. You got even with us. There's old brothers.
Well, that's right. When you came out, the whites looked like the blacks, so it wasn't any different. So you knew you was getting plenty of dust.
There are also miners that are working and who are very symptomatic, but who don't dare quit unless they can be reassured that they have sufficient impairment that they'll be able to collect some sort of disability benefits. And it's a kind of a negative system, because what we do is we really force them to keep working until they become that disabled.
He went to the boss man, but he closed the door. Well, it seems you're not wanted.
Very good.
When you're sick and you're poor, you're not even covered in their medical plans, and your life depends on the favors of man.
We want to do the right thing about poll workers' pneumoconiosis, but we think that the best informed medical opinion will show you that it's not true that the inhalation and retention of coal dust in the lungs necessarily results in any impairment of pulmonary function, and that on the contrary, only a relatively small portion of coal miners who have coal dust retained in the lungs have any resulting impairment of pulmonary function, much less disability.
This is one of your brother's lungs, and this is what it looks like at autopsy, and this is why he died. That's preventable.
Other countries have done it. Other countries have made tremendous strides. For example, the Australians believe that they've completely eliminated the problem of lung disease in their coal miners.
Down at the graveyard, the boss man came with his little bunch of flowers. Dear God, what a shame. Take back those flowers. Don't you sing the sad song. The die has been cast now. A good man is gone.
It turns out that 1969 was a year for an election in the United Mine Workers Union. And with all the dissatisfaction that was going on, there was really, for the first time, I guess, in the union's history, there was really open talk of people opposing Tony Boyle.
40 years I have to work in a mine to get a pension. A meager pension at that. And I suppose when I do quit, which will be in 2 years because I can't stand it anymore, I won't be able to get silicosis because you have to be dead.
I doubt Tony Boyle's ever known what coal dust is on his hands. Oh, he's sitting back there, up there in Washington, drawing a big amount of money. What for? He don't even know what the miners goes through. And the hell with him. That's the way I feel.
Boyle's doing nothing for the widows. Boyle doing nothing for the pensioners. I'll give you this. I'll give you that. I'll give you pie. If I can reach high enough in the sky. In the sweet by and by.
Well, the coal miners in this country are damn sick and tired of having a national president of its organization that's in bed with the coal operators.
Pennsylvania is not too far from here. Coal miners were hoping for a brighter new year. But for Jockey Blonsky, his daughter and keeps the working man down.
Now we have 9 paid holidays, and I think the one that tops them all is the holiday for your birthday. Every miner is given the opportunity to work on his birthday, and he receives triple time for working on his birthday. I think that's really something to be proud of. And this is the thought and the idea and the accomplishment of President Boyle.
You know, when they asked me how many terms do you want, you know how many terms I told him? I told him. I said, just as long as the supreme being up there gives me the intellect and the health to carry on and the membership elect me to office, that's how many terms I want until I'm 180 years of age.
Can you tell us just where the bodies were found and some of the circumstances surrounding the discovery?
Well, the daughter was in a bedroom adjoining the master bedroom, and the Mr. and Mrs. Yablansky were in the master bedroom.
The events in Washington, Pennsylvania show that murder is as institutionalized within the UMWA as it is in the mafia. The order to kill the whole family if necessary, was as routinely transmitted and carried out as an order to call a strike or settle a grievance.
We loved and admired our father. We respected him. And my brother and I would like to carry him to his final resting place. But we deem it proper to do otherwise. My brother Joseph, with our cousins from my mother's family, will carry our mother. And I, with our cousins from my father's family, will carry our sister Charlotte. We entrust our father to the coal miners whom he loves so much.
Oh, death, oh, death, please spare me, over for another year. Please spare me, over for another year. The children pray, the preacher preach, time and mercy's out of reach. Said death I come to take the soul, leave the body and leave it cold. Take the skin right off the brain. Earth and worms both have their claim. Oh, death. Oh, death. Please spare me over for another year. Please spare me over for another year.
In 1969, there wasn't any reform organization. This is 1972, and this is the year for Miners for Democracy. Now you can look around and see your brothers in other districts who are willing to stand shoulder to shoulder with you to throw Boyle and his crowd out for once and for all.
I'm proud of the honor of heading up a slate of rank-and-file candidates for the international offices for rank-and-file miners. We must have a safety program that will guarantee our members a safe journey to and from the mines, not one which accepts that we must lose 200 or 300 men every year in mining. I want to make it plain that my commitment is to the rank-and-file miner.
When the 9th of December rolls around, we'll have our election day. And Boyle, you better sit up and listen, 'cause here's what we're gonna say. Oh, Tony Bennett's the top too long, been stealing all our pay. But Miller is here in the time. There's coming a reckoning day. Coming a reckoning
day. I now pronounce you President of United Mine Workers of America.
Congratulations.
Which office was this?
This was Boyle's old office, and the other one was Suzanne Richards' old office. Neither lives here anymore.
Yeah, thank you.
sign a 20-cent royalty for
Peabody.
Peabody Coal Company.
What'd you say?
Mr. Boyle was giving a civil deposition when he was intruded upon by three FBI agents. I think that's grossly unfair.
Never expected that that was going to come through anything like this.
Why?
Paul?
Because I had no forewarning.
What about the charges, so?
Well, as I read the charge, I'm not supposed to say anything.
Come on,
Tom.
As you read the charge, what?
As bad as the killers are, a Vili and a Gilly and whatever they may be, they don't compare to the people at the top who would use the blood and sweat of miners to finance for killing.
Excuse us, please. Excuse me.
United Mine Works today is a labor organization of rank and file miners, led by rank and file miners for rank and file miners, and that's the way it ought to be.
I want to introduce to all of you now, and I expect that most of you already know her, Miss Florence Reese.
I'm not a coal miner, as you well know, but I'm as close as I could be not to be one. My father was a coal miner who was killed in the mines, and my husband is slowly dying with black lung. And my husband and me was in the strike in the 30s in bloody Harlan County, and I do mean it is bloody, too. And they tell me, these miners say, we're going to stick it out unless Duke Power signs the contract till hell freezes over. Nothing to lose but their chains and their union to gain. So I say, hang in there. And now this song I composed in the 30s. And as you know, I'm old, that's 40 years ago, and I can't sing very well. But you can ask the scabs and the gun thugs which side they're on, because they're workers too. Come all you poor workers, good news to you I'll tell. How the good old union has come in here to dwell. Which side are you on? Which side are you on? If you go to Harlan County, there is no neutral there. You'll either be a union man or a thug for J.H. Blair. Which side are you on? Which side are you on?
What about this gun being pulled?
Oh, he pulled it right here. He had it concealed in a rag.
He told me that he'd blow us. If we got in his way again, he would mow us down. I told him, I said, I'll see you in federal court Monday if you say that again, sir. We're here on peaceful business. And so he put it back in his holster then, wrapped it back up in a rag, and got back in his car.
But he did pull the gun and point it. That's Basil Collins. That's a gun thug. He is a known strike breaker. That man is the gun thug. He's the same one that came up here before. And he had the gun in the car whenever Reb was talking to him.
And he's a cruising around here now, going up and down, trying to find out who's here, you see.
Who are you working with, honey?
What?
Who do you work with? Press. Will you show me your press card?
It's in the car. And get my
show
press
me your
card.
Press card.
Okay. What's your name, sir?
My name is Basil Collins.
Do you work here?
Yes, ma'am.
What's your position here?
Mine for me.
How do you feel about the people picketing out here?
Well, I would have no comment on that.
And you, sir?
Same thing.
Where's this press card you was going to show me?
Can I see your identification?
Ma'am?
May I see your identification?
Yes, ma'am. If I had him, I swear I've lost it. All I do is just
I think I might have misplaced mine, too.
Okay. Okay.
All right.
He had the nerve enough, believe it or not, to run for sheriff.
We're not going to have the violence of the 30s. The conditions are not the same.
There is probably nothing illegal or immoral about the union trying to get the best contract they can, including the one they have with everyone else. On the other hand, the fact that somebody else has made a contract with the United Mine Workers doesn't raise any obligation on our part, as I see it, legally or morally, to accept that contract any more than we could go to the union and say we want you to accept the Southern Labor Union contract, which we have at two other mines.
Is it as simple as that? You do not want the major industry agreement with United Mine Workers. That is the 1971 agreement.
It's that simple, yes, sir. If you want to make it simple.
And with that, we'll break for our last round of questions and comments. I would just like to say quick on Joseph Yablonski, it was found out that his murder was contracted out by Boyle, and he embezzled $20,000 in union funds to carry it out.
Watching this has been good for me. This is our real history, real American history. One could say that this culture that's been imposed upon us since the 1980s, you know, the Ferris Bueller, it's great stuff. I like it. You know, we like it. It's America, but this is the real America we're watching here. And seeing the woman, I forget her name, her dad was a miner, her husband's a miner, and she wrote, "Which side are you on?" That's who we are.
Yeah, no, this has been a real good look at slice of real America, as Chris mentioned. And at least for me, it really strikes me how some of these people at the top, there's just zero empathy for their fellow men. It's just so striking to me. My goodness.
Yeah, and I just want to add one thing on the murder of Joseph Yablonski. It was mentioned that it was almost like a murder for hire, like the mafia. Even the mafia won't kill the family. They'll just kill the person they're in. But...
yeah, it's funny that Chris said that, because I was showing my mom part of the movie, and I pointed at the part where it showed the coal miner where they were talking about the black lung. I was like, this is the real America that people don't know about. People in other countries, they want to come here. They think the U.S. is like all full of rich people. They don't realize that the ordinary workers struggle just as much as anywhere else. And most people don't even know about how terrible the working conditions are, even people here in the cities.
Yes, and those people that come over here will be the first ones that get exploited like that to the max.
Yeah, so I was, you know, just looking up some, you know, some statistics over, I was looking at a number of coal mine disasters, like explosions and stuff, and I noticed there was a big downward trend. There was like a spike in the 20s and 30s. So I was curious. I found out that it corresponded almost directly with the employment over time. That was the highest employment in mining in the 20s and 30s. But on a similar, you know, a similar note, I was looking into grain elevator disasters over time. And what I noticed was, there was a downward trend in explosions and fatalities up until 1990, and then suddenly it started going back up again. And I think people can, figure out what that correlation is. But Yeah, it's just interesting to me that we're kind of going back into that path of, deregulation and whatnot.
I think, just to reiterate, that it's so important for us to try and work within our unions to bring them back to the path of class struggle and to have a class-oriented mindset, because without that level of education, people are really left to the conservative and oftentimes reactionary leadership that are in leadership of unions today. And it has a profound effect, not just on the workers themselves, but as we see on their families as well. It involves every aspect of their lives. And that has a massive effect on the future, really, because we're left with the legacy of the workers that we saw in the film today. And a lot of people like to say that every safety regulation was written in blood. It was written in blood from the people who got hurt, and then it was written in blood by the people who fought to have the law.
And you spoke and reminded me of one more thing. One more point I wanted to make. We saw mentioned in the video, the Mine Workers for Democracy, the caucus that was built after the death of Joseph Yablonski. And we could see mistakes that were, there were mistakes made there. As soon as they won power, they dissolved caucus, viewing it as a potential threat to their power. And that only hurt them in the long run. And with that, we'll go to our closeout slides. Once again, the Harry Bridges School of Labor is presented by Labor United Educational League. And you can find us on various social media platforms, on Twitter at @Lul_US, at Instagram at @Lul.US, on Facebook at LaborUnited.Lul, and on YouTube at Labor United. And of course, you can find us on our website at www.lul.us and on our publication, labortoday.lul.us. And of course, we'll be continuing our viewing of Harlan County USA this Saturday, 7 p.m. Eastern. The next month's session will take place on Wednesday, September 4th, and repeated on Saturday, September 7th. And it will be the history of TOOL, our predecessor organization, or the Trade Union Educational League. With that, we'll play our closeout song, and it's Florence Reese's, the song written by Florence Reese from the strike in the 1920s in Harlan County, 1930s. Which side are you on?